All you ladies, we're going to have our women's Christmas party, WM's Christmas party, on November 30th. It's a Tuesday evening. We'd like for everyone to come out. We'd like for ones that's not been for a long time and new ones to come. And we're going to have a good time in fellowship. It will be at 6 p.m. down in the gymnasium. We're going to have a baked potato bar and soup and desserts and drinks, and we'll provide that. You don't need to bring anything. The only thing you bring is a $10 gift if you want to do the gift exchange. So I'm hoping to see you all out there. And we're going to have a good time in fellowship.
Amen. Thank you, Leah. Thank you so much. Hey, it's good to be in the house of the Lord on Sunday morning. Would you stand with me today as we open up service in prayer? And as people come in and find a place to settle in for the day, let's just prepare to give God the glory for what He is doing in our world today and for who He is. Heavenly Father, we just come to You today. We come to the throne of grace. We come celebrating the love of God. We come seeking Your face for guidance and for wisdom for the future. And Lord, we seek You for comfort for today. We pray, Lord, that You would be with Your people, and may Your light shine on our path, and may the joy of the Lord manifest in the house of God today as we worship You. May we come with thankfulness, with gratefulness for all the things that You've done for us. God, You're so good, and we are prepared to give You the praise and the thanks today in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Let's give the Lord a praise offering today. Amen.
When upon life's billows you are tempest tossed, when you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one, count your blessings, see what God has done. Are you ever burdened with a load of care? Does the cross seem heavy you are called to bear? Count your many blessings, every doubt will fly, and you will be singing as the days go by. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. See what God has done. When you look at others, there's their lands and gold. Think that Christ has promised you His wealth and gold. Count your many blessings money cannot buy, your reward in heaven nor your home on high. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. What God has done. So amid the conflict, whether great or small, do not be discouraged, God is over all. Count your many blessings, angels will attend, help and comfort give you to your journey's end. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. God has done. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and they are saved. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. Just run into it, and they are saved. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Most High. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Most High. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Most High. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Most High. Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. Yeah. has provided.
I seek your face. Hey, Pastor Bush. Let's go back to that last song that we sung with No Higher Calling. God is wanting to do something here today. This song just speaks to me. I mean, there's no greater honor than to bow at the feet of Jesus. And I don't know what it is. I usually don't do this, but I just feel like we need to sing this again.
Down at your feet. Your face, I see. Jesus, 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 there's just something.
Of the Lord. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Kurata shanda lama kondo robo sindia kando. No kuramo shikila mahanda lobo sondra bakanda. No rabasoko no mahonda la bakanda la basiondo.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Of God. We're here to meet with our God. We're here to meet with the Lord. We're here because God is real. We're here because He inhabits the praises of His people. We're here because He has a great plan and purpose for our lives, and He does His transforming work in us as we surrender to Him, to His will, to His grace, to His love. Hallelujah. Hey, we're in the presence of God today. Amen. And he's up to something. Amen. Amen. Is that okay? Amen. Amen. Is that okay if God's up to something? Amen. Can we just give the Lord a praise offering today? Amen. And could we just right now tune in to His frequency and say, Lord, whatever You have to say to us, Lord, whatever You want to do in us today, Lord, may our ears be open. May our eyes open toward heaven, toward You, toward Your plan, toward Your purpose, toward who You are. May we see You today, Lord. And Father, may Your presence move among us freely. And Father, we just pray that we would get everything out of the way that might hinder, that might stand in the way, whether it's sin, whether it's self, whether it's whether it's the burdens of life. Father, we just put that all off to the side today. Today it's just about You coming and being with us here in the house of God. And Father, we treasure this time. We savor this time with You today and Your people. God, You're so good. You're so good. May You just lead and guide us as this service progresses today. May we be sensitive to the voice of God and to the leading of the Holy Spirit. Father, we ask this in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. All God's people said, amen, amen, amen. Praise God, praise God. You may be seated. We're going to have intercessory prayer at the end of the service today, and I've got a sister. She's my favorite sister, also the only one, who's going in for open-heart surgery at the age of 78, tomorrow in Cedar Rapids, Iowa. And at the end of the service, Tammy's going to come down and stand in the prayer line for her. And also wanted to share with you that Pastor David and Judy Adkins both have tested positive for the virus down in Missouri. And I was talking to David yesterday. He said it just feels like he's got the flu. But appreciate your prayers for David and Judy. Judy's got it not quite as severe. And also Donna Pittman is home not feeling well today. Want to keep her in our prayers. Also, let's remember the family of Don Perry. Don Perry, who has a connection to our church that goes way, way back, passed away at, I believe it was the age of 89. And so appreciate your prayers for the Perry family. Amen. Amen. Let's have our men come this morning as we receive Sunday morning tithe and offering. And let's just continue to be sensitive to what the Lord is doing among us today. Amen. Praise God. Thank you so much for your partnership in the work of the kingdom. Brother Kent, would you lead us out in prayer this morning as we prepare to give back and invest into the kingdom of God.
Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for today, Lord. We just thank you for your word here today, Lord, each and every one of us. Lord, we just pray for these monies that are being collected today. Lord, we just pray that they be good, put to good use of your kingdom, Lord, that they would be a blessing. Lord, we just thank you for all that you do. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. Pastor Phoebe, could you come and share some reports and announcements here today? Hey, it's good to be in the house of the Lord. I'm glad I came to church today.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Pastor Phoebe is fresh back from youth convention.
I'm not sure fresh is the word, but I'm back. We actually ended up not being able to go up on Friday evening because of some circumstances that came up, so we went up yesterday morning. We left bright and early yesterday, and the girls left my house at 10:30 last night, so I'm dragging a little bit this morning, right? But as Rex stopped and was talking about that song, No Greater Calling, I was thinking as we were singing it the first time that that's exactly how I have felt. I have been tired this month. It has been a long month with Trunk or Treat and then Fun Arts and now convention and going into Thanksgiving, and we're going to do a Friendsgiving dinner with the kids, and so lots going on. And I thought, but you know, there's no greater calling, right, than what we do for God. We're all, you know, some of y'all come in on Wednesday nights and work with the kids. Some of you do it on Sunday mornings and all throughout the week, and there's just no greater job that we could be doing than working and trying to grow the kingdom, right? At convention yesterday, one of the things that was mentioned that just completely stuck in my mind was that 42% of the people on earth have never heard. And that seems unfathomable to me because, you know, being here in the United States and most people, even if they don't attend church, even if, you know, they don't believe whatever they've heard, right? And maybe I'm wrong. Maybe there are more people around us that haven't heard than I even can imagine. But, you know, a lot of the countries, there's just people there that have never heard the name of Jesus, let alone the gospel and what it can mean to each of us. And that just really stuck in my head yesterday. And I think it must have stuck in theirs, too, because that was all during the Speed the Light message and service that morning and talking about how, you know, it's our job to reach out and reach out to those people who are lost and out in the world. And so before service is even over, and I hear chirping amongst them going on beside me, and I'm like, what are they stirring up over there? So y'all, before we get to what they've concocted and come up with, I'm going to let them talk about convention and what they got out of it, and then we'll talk about a fundraiser we're about to kick off that transpired last night. So, all right, Miss McKenzie. McKenzie, as y'all know, graduated, right? So she shouldn't be going with us to convention. But I've talked to Pastor Bush, and we have got her plugged into the Women's Sunday School class, and she's downstairs with them, and I'm glad she's doing that. But we've also pulled her in, and she's working alongside us with the kids, and she did a great job yesterday going with me in Scott's place, and she's doing a great job helping keep the kids corralled and do all that we need to do with them. So we're grateful for McKenzie.
Well, it was a fun time yesterday, lots of laughter. So two things that stuck out to me was have a time and a place to pray and read your Bible every day. That just like kind of stuck. And then another thing was the goal is not to get through the Bible, it's for the Bible to get through you.
Thank you for the board allowing us to go. Thank you for supporting us in the past, and I know you will in the future. I had fun at convention. Elaine Furr said, find a place and time to pray and read the Bible every day. I like that a lot because I've been slacking of this. And then Billy Warland, which is the new DYD, had an altar call if he wanted to get refilled with the Spirit. I went down and I got refilled. Thank you.
So Alexis Smith went with us also yesterday, but she wasn't able to be here this morning. So the three of them and myself went up yesterday. And when McKenzie says lots of laughter, she is not kidding. I don't know what it was yesterday in the air, but we laughed all the way there and all the way back. We had a great time. But as they both mentioned, Elaine didn't preach. I know most of you know who Elaine is. Steve and Elaine have been the district youth directors for 29, I think, almost 30 years. And they are retiring, and so this was their last youth convention and their last time to kind of be on stage, and Billy Warland from Linton is taking their place, him and Karen, and I think they'll do a fabulous job. But as they were saying their farewells, Elaine came up and she made that statement, find a time and place to pray and read your Bible every day. And, you know, I told them in Sunday school this morning, that seems like such a simplistic statement, yet it can mean so much to all of us, right, if we really do that each and every day and spend time where we're supposed to. But through the course of this, you know, it's fun. We have laughter. We enjoy the services. But it's about relationship, right? We develop relationships with ourselves, or with each other, not ourselves, with each other within our group. But it's also about developing those relationships to the point where they will go out and share. And so that's what we've been encouraging them to do, is to share and go out in and to support Speed the Light, because that's how our missionaries are able to share. And so they've concocted a plan. I think Mackenzie's going to discuss this. I was not involved in this too much degree. And so they've done this on their own. I'm proud of them, because they were talking about all of our goals for Speed the Light. And last year when we were at convention, we set a goal for $10,000, which just seems crazy when you think about it, that we could raise that much money in the course of a year. But as I've gone through the numbers this week, we're sitting right at $8,000. And so they decided they wanted to make a final push to try to get to that $10,000 goal. So I'll let Mackenzie talk about what they're going to do, and y'all can laugh and have fun with them, right?
Okay, so we decided yesterday to do a pie in the face, and we are, like, so close to our goal, only 2,000 more. So each pie is going to be $25, and you get to pick who you pie in the face. You can either do me, Xander, or Alexis, and then that will do to the 2,000. Now, if we hit 3,000, you're going to do Scott or Phoebe. So the date is to be determined, and any donations will be greatly appreciated.
Brandy, I think discussion in Sunday school this morning was how many people would pay to pie you in the face. So we may have to see who else we have. Eric's going, I will. So we may have to see who else we can get in here. I think Marcia was the end of this a few years ago, where she got pulled into getting pied in the face. So we may have to see if Brandy will be our person this year to pull in. So anyway, we're going to do this. We haven't set a date yet, but if you would like to donate to Speed the Light and buy a pie to pie one of the kids, or potentially ultimately Scott and I, some point in December, we will set a date, and we'll do it after a Sunday morning service. But if you want to donate, just take one of your little envelopes and put Speed the Light pie on it and drop it in the offering, or give it to one of us, and we'll get it in and get it accounted for that away. Put your name on it, obviously, so we know who is in charge of that pie, unless you just want it to be an anonymous donation. But we thank you for all you guys do for us all year long for Speed the Light, and we'll see how close we can get to their goal. I have confidence that they're going to push really hard to make sure that I get to eat a pie. They just said $1,000. She's like, we'll see how this all transpires. But thank you all for supporting us.
You know, Brandy, that reminds me of people that think they can buy their way into heaven. Can't do that. Yeah. I'm sure it's the Lord's will. Bruce has a song this morning. Come on ahead, Bruce, and lead us in worship.
You know, before I sing this, I just want to recognize a very special person in the life of Lola and I. And today is Felicity's 12th birthday today. So, I'm grateful for that. And I'm a little, I walk with trepidation, though, because in 1 year that means she'll be a teenager and she will know everything and I will know nothing, you know. But she's back there going, oh, Grandpa, don't do that. But anyhow, This song, I realize we're not quite to Thanksgiving yet, but we'll be there very soon. And I've always loved this song, The First Noel, and I especially was excited about the word that the Lord shared with us this morning. We go back into session on Tuesday and up at the State House, and I know there's going to be a lot of battles up there. I mean, we're already in the middle of many, many battles. In fact, the interesting thing is that we actually never went out of session because of what was going on this year, and so it's the beginning of the new session. So be in prayer that we will be seeking God's wisdom as we make decisions for the state of Indiana. But more and more these days, we're not only making decisions that are impacting us right here within the boundaries of the state, but we're having to do battle with the federal government. I mean, it's just really. That's almost more of our battle than anything these days. But anyhow, Christ came in the world when things weren't great either. He came as a child, and it's so exciting what Christmas represents, and it was basically something that actually we should celebrate all year round. But anyhow, the first Noel.
The first Noel, the angel did say, was to certain poor shepherds in fields as they lay, in fields where they lay keeping their sheep on a cold winter's night. That was so deep. Noel, 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 Noel. Born is the King of Israel. They looked up and saw a star shining in the east, beyond them far and to the earth, it gave great light, and so it continued both day and night. Noel,
for the record, Pastor Sam is going to be 75 in a couple of weeks. And on Friday night, we were at our French's skating rink, and Sam was out there zipping around almost 75 years. How about that? Has the Lord blessed him or what?
Did you see that one flip that I did?
Yeah, but it wasn't on purpose.
Bruce, we appreciate you representing the biblical worldview up in the State House, and we do wish Felicity a happy birthday today. It's great to see Connie, Ruth's daughter Connie from Ohio here. Wave at us, would you, Connie? God bless you. Amen. Amen. All right. Would you open your Bibles today to Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 35? Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 35. We're not going to be in Hebrews chapter 11 much longer. I think next Sunday will be the last message in the series of messages on real faith. It's taken us almost a whole year to cover this chapter in the Bible, but it is so powerfully important for us to face the unknown future with great faith, with real faith, because we know according to God's word that there's going to be a great trouble and tribulation in the future at some point. And we see that developing in our world today, and it's quite shocking and it's quite alarming for all of us. And the answer for us as God's people is to face the future not with fear but with faith. Can I get an amen on that this morning? All right, would you stand with me today as we read Hebrews chapter 11, verse 35 through 37. We touched on this last Sunday. We're going to take it a step farther today. It says, others were tortured, not accepting deliverance, that they might obtain a better resurrection. Still others had trials of mockings and scourgings, yes, and of chains and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn in two, they were tempted, were slain with the sword. They wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, tormented, of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts and mountains, in dens and caves of the earth. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the faith that endures and perseveres through thick and thin. And Lord, we have to say in our humanity, we would rather that our days on this earth were spent in pleasure and in comfort and in ease. But Lord, we know that the reality is that there is tribulation and trouble and trials that come to every man and woman of faith. Everyone who follows Jesus will follow in the steps of Jesus, even as Jesus experienced suffering. Also, we will experience times when we will need to lean on you and go deeper into our faith even more. And Father, we just pray your guidance and blessing upon your word today as we receive it into our hearts and minds. And everybody said, amen, amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Praise God, praise God. Now, if we could go to Hebrews chapter 33 and through 35. Just go back a few verses here. Here it is. There it says, this is right before the scriptures that I read this morning that have to do with the story of the saints of God who experienced great suffering and trials and troubles, persecution, even death. Here's what it says about some of the other saints of God that had faith. That through faith they subdued kingdoms, they wrought righteousness, they obtained promises, they stopped the mouths of lions. Quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, and out of weakness were made strong, waxed valiant in fight, turned to flight the armies of the aliens, and women received their dead raised to life again. Now that's the kind of real faith that we love talking about the miracles, you know, about the great signs of God's power and the deliverance and the healing and the blessing and the victory that comes through faith. But there's, just like a coin, there's two sides to our faith. And on the one hand, you have divine intervention. You have God manifesting himself through works of power and grace and miracles of God. And on the other hand, you have the times in your life when you feel like God's a million miles away. And when you go through trouble and you go through trials and you wonder, God, what is your purpose in all of this? And it's true as Christians, at some point, I'm pretty well convinced that every believer, everyone who follows Christ, will ask the question, why do I have to go through this trial? How many's ever asked that question before? Why has this come upon me? Why do I have to go through this agony, this trouble, why do I have to carry these burdens? And I was reading in Job chapter 1, where it says in verse 12, if we can get that up on the wall, please. And the Lord said to Satan, behold, all that Job has is in your hand, only do not lay a hand on his person. And then in chapter 2 and verse 6, so the Lord said to Satan, behold, Job is in your power, only spare his life. Now, here's the question. Why does our Heavenly Father who loves us, amen? How many knows that God loves you? Amen. He's with you. Why does he sometimes give the devil divine permission to afflict the people of God? That's a big question. That's a question that probably every Christian either has asked or will ask. And it's just amazing when you think that our loving God, we know that God is good, that he is benevolent, that he works everything together for good. Sometimes he allows us to go through seasons of suffering and loss and trouble. And there must be, I think the only answer to that question is there must be some divine redemptive purpose in the sufferings that we experience in life. When our life seems like no matter what we do, we can't fix the problem. It won't go away. We're called upon to go through those fiery trials. Now I want to share with you this morning a story of a great family in history. None of them are alive anymore. They've all passed on to their eternal rewards, so I guess it'd be okay to talk about them this morning. Let's put their picture up on the wall here today, shall we? Do we have a picture of this family? There it is right there. Does anybody recognize this family? It's got their names written there. This is Betsy. On the left is Betsy, then Nolly, and then the dad is Caspar, and his wife is Cornelia. In the back you have Willem. You have Willem. And then over on the right side, the youngest one in the family, her name is Corey. Cricket says, Corey Ten Boom. This is the Ten Boom family. From they lived in a past generation in a place called Holland in the Netherlands over there in Europe. And they were a family that life was good for the Ten Booms. They were Christians. They belonged to the Dutch Reformed Church. They were faithful to God, loved the Lord. Very, very religious family, strong Christian faith. And one thing about the Ten Boom family is that they had a special love for God's chosen people from the Old Testament, that is Israel. They loved Israel. But they lived in an era, they lived in a time where the world was going crazy. And so I think that all of us can probably identify with what happened to them, because it seems like our world is in a way going crazy. Amen. Except their world went crazier than our world is going at this point. And that's, I want to share their story here, because their story is a tremendous inspiration that God in his infinite wisdom allowed this family to go through a season of terrible persecution and trouble. Most of them ended up in the concentration camps because they had opened their home to the Jews who were trying to get out of Holland. Because the rise of the Nazis under Hitler back in 1944, Holland fell to Germany. Germany invaded, and it changed everything in Holland. And their comfortable, peaceful life was turned totally upside down. And the Nazis began to sweep through the community where they lived and through the entire country and rounding up all the Jewish people. The Jewish people had to wear a yellow star on their clothing. And they were channeling all of these Jewish people, getting them out of the country, taking them to the concentration camps to punish them to destroy them, to try to get rid of them. And the Ten Boom family, led by Caspar Ten Boom, this man of God, knew that they had to do something to help. But it was dangerous because it was politically incorrect to help the Jews. But if you're familiar at all with the story of the hiding place, you know that for a season of almost a year, the home of the Ten Booms was opened to those Jewish people who were being persecuted. And until the Nazis raided their home and took all the Ten Booms and their relatives away and put them in prison, they helped about 600 Jewish people to escape Holland, to get to a place of safety. And so this is a tremendous story where they did so much good, but it was at such tremendous personal cost. Many of them not only lost their livelihoods and their health, but many of them lost their lives. Now, Corrie ten Boom did not lose her life, even though her father and her sister and her brother and others in the family were murdered by the Nazis. She, by the providence of God, was able to be released from Ravensbrück prison in Germany. And for 31 years, she traveled not only the country, but she traveled the world. And she went into about 60 countries of the world over the span of 31 years. And if you remember the era when Billy Graham was doing his great crusades all across the country and world, one of his favorite guests to have to give testimony at a Billy Graham crusade was Corrie ten Boom. And I remember that from my youth, from my younger days, when I would hear Corrie ten Boom testifying about what God did and how God helped her through that terrible, terrible time in history where she and her family suffered so very, very much. Now, one thing about Corrie ten Boom, she was a very eloquent speaker, very passionate speaker. Her love for God and her love for God's people just radiated through everything she said. And she's one of the most quotable people that I've ever heard or I've ever read. And one of her most famous quotes was this: "There is no pit so deep that God is not deeper still." That is a powerful statement that came out of her experience, because she and her family had been placed into a very deep and dark pit of despair and hopelessness. But she found out that through her faith in Almighty God, that God was deeper than the pit that she was suffering in. Praise God. Praise God. Here's another quote from Corrie ten Boom. She said, "With Jesus, even in our darkest moments, the best remains, and the very best is yet to come." There she was speaking of the hope that those who follow Jesus have, though no matter what you are called upon to go through on this earth, that one day all of our suffering and all of our trials will work for eternal glory. The Apostle Paul said in Romans chapter 8, verse 18, "The sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us." Amen. So no matter how dark the day may seem, no matter how difficult the journey, no matter how much pain and suffering is involved, we know that that's temporary, but we've got our eyes fixed on the eternal. And we're on a journey that leads to heaven, to the presence of God, where there'll be no devil, there'll be no wickedness, there'll be no sin, there'll be no condemnation. There will only be eternal joy and purpose in heaven throughout all of eternity. Amen. Praise God. Now, if you can just imagine for a moment what it would be like to live in Holland in the 1940s And to hear over the radio that the Germans had invaded and Hitler's armies were on the move. They were trying to take over the whole continent. And now the government of Holland had fallen and there was a new government coming in place. It would mean that life is going to be very, very different from this point forward. You can imagine the fear and the hopelessness that came upon the people of Holland at that time. Now, if you were to go to Holland, to the city of Haarlem in the Netherlands, you would be able to go to this house right here. This is the Ten Boom House, where they had the watchmaker shop. Both Casper and Corey were licensed watchmakers, and they had a very strong, small business going there. And then they lived in the two stories above the shop. But they have turned, because of Corey's work and her vision to turn her suffering into blessing, just a couple of years after her death, were able to make this into a museum. And if you would ever go over to Holland, you could go through that museum and have about an hour-long tour. That would be a great inspiration to you. So if you ever want to go to Europe and go on a vacation, make sure you go to Holland, to Haarlem, and you tour the Ten Boom House. And there's a name for this house. It's called the Hiding Place. That's where they hid the Jews during this very terrible season. Now, if you're not able to go over to Haarlem in the Netherlands anytime soon, here's the good news. You can go on your computer and just Google the Hiding Place or Corrie ten Boom's house. And they'll take you through a virtual tour of the Hiding Place. How many thinks that'd be a good thing to do? Instead of taking an afternoon nap Sunday afternoon, I'm going to go home and take the virtual tour of the Hiding Place. That would be an awesome thing to do. Very, very amazingly inspirational. And so the amazing thing about it is that the terror and the horror of World War II and the atrocities of the Nazi regime, all of those things are in the past. And what has come out of all of that pain and all of that suffering is this tremendous testimony to the faithfulness of God. Remember we sang that great old hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Now, you see, this is serving as a witness and a testimony to the truth of the reality of God. That there is a God who takes everything and works it together for something good. He even takes the painful stuff and works it together for good. And we see that illustrated in the story of the Hiding Place, where Corey's faith, through her suffering, through her loss, losing family members, and the atrocities that were forced upon her family, she made a decision that she was going to find a deeper faith. So that's why the theme of this service today is that real faith goes deeper. Would you turn to your neighbor and smile at him today and say, hey, real faith goes deeper. Amen. Because there's no pit so deep but that God is not deeper still. Amen. Amen. Now, you see, we have, it's kind of like a tree. When drought comes, that tree has two choices. It can either shrivel up and die, or it can send its roots down deeper. Send its roots down deeper where it can find enough water to survive. Amen. And we have two choices. When unjust suffering comes our way, we can either turn against God and we can either separate ourselves from God, or we can blame God, or we can go deeper into God. We can go deeper into our faith. This is a choice we have. See, in Proverbs chapter 24 and verse 10, The Bible says if you faint in the day of adversity, your strength is small. What we need when we find that adversity is coming our way is more strength. We need a deeper strength. We need deeper faith. We need a deeper courage to be able to do what is right instead of caving to what is convenient and what is easy. We all need to go deeper. And I believe that the era that we're living in right now is a time where days are coming where we all will need a stronger, tougher, deeper faith. Amen. Amen? I say the days are upon us, the days are ahead, where this is what we will need. We'll need a faith that will endure. Amen. A faith that will hold steady. A faith that will prevail. A faith that will contend for the faith once delivered to the saints. There's an old saying that says, when the going gets tough, the tough get going. Amen. Amen. That's what the Bible says in Daniel chapter 11, verse 32. And remember, Daniel chapter 11, that the context of that is the end times. And what does the scripture say? This is the word, the prophetic word that comes to Daniel, that those who do wickedly against the covenant, he that is the Antichrist will corrupt with flattery. And so there'll be a lot of corruption in the time of the Antichrist. You know what? I think we're in that season, aren't we? Because there's so much corruption. Yeah, but look what else it says. The people who know their God shall be strong and shall do exploits. Amen. Amen. That's why I love the story of the Ten Boom family. Because you know what? They were just an ordinary family, ordinary people. There they are right there back in the mid-1940s. Ordinary folks who did extraordinary exploits. They were willing to put their own necks on the line to save lives. They were willing to risk their own freedom by proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ and taking a stand for truth when deception was sweeping the entire continent. So, extraordinary exploits from ordinary folks. Praise God. You know, Jesus said in Luke chapter 6 that anyone who comes to Jesus, he said, and hears my words and does them, this is what he's like. He's like a man building a house who dug deep and laid the foundation on the rock. And when the flood arose and the stream broke against that house, it could not be shaken because it had been well built. Now, I want you to notice something about that scripture there in Luke chapter 6, verse 48. And I believe this is the key to building a life that will withstand the pressures of time, the pressures of the world. Look again right here. On the second line it says, he dug deep. You see, real faith goes deeper. And the man who builds a house that will stand, before he builds the house, he digs deep. He looks for a faith that will go deep, that will sustain him through all the trials and pressures of life, no matter what those may be. We know that people who rise above suffering and sorrow have one thing in common. What is it? They know how to go deeper in the faith. Amen. They know how to go deeper. Amen. Others are destroyed by circumstances. They cave to the social pressures, the political pressures, and they compromise their faith. But there are a people who will stand firm. Those are the ones who have laid a strong and deep foundation in the truth. Amen. And whose strongest desire is not to just get by and to stay invisible in the world when trouble comes, but their deepest desire is to do the things that are pleasing to the Lord. Amen. Praise God. And that's the message of Hebrews chapter 11. Earlier this week, I was started to send out some text about different individuals who went deeper into the faith. And Job was one of them. You know, Job's wife said, why don't you just curse God and die? Why don't you just give up and leave this life? And he said, woman, you speak as one of the foolish women. Shall I not accept adversity from God and only accept blessing and prosperity? Somehow he didn't understand it, but he believed that God had a purpose for what he was going through. And when you read the whole book, you see how God used that time of suffering to draw him into a deeper, stronger faith. And he remains an inspiration to everybody who follows Christ today. And then you read about the Apostle Paul, how he tried to do good and he suffered for it. And yet his heart's desire was to share in the sufferings of Christ that he might also share in the victory of his resurrection. Praise God. And then you read the stories of people like Joseph, you know, who suffered unjustly, and yet God turned it around for something good. And Moses, you know, how he went through so much ridicule and persecution, and yet God elevated him and used him in such a powerful way. And Ruth, you know, how she experienced loss, and yet God used that to position her to be an ancestor of the Messiah. You know, we only see the small slice of time, which is our lives, but God sees the whole big picture. And he has great plans for those who follow him. But the devil, now here's the thing about suffering. There's two things you need to know about suffering. Number one, the devil uses our suffering to destroy. The devil wants to use suffering to destroy us, to destroy our faith, to get us to turn on God and to give up on God. But God uses our suffering to build. To build us stronger, to build us steadier, to build a testimony in us that future generations will look back and they'll be amazed and they will give God the glory for how God brought us through that time of trouble. Amen. And that's what the hiding place is all about. How many of you folks have ever seen the Hiding Place movie? You know, Corrie ten Boom wrote a book called The Hiding Place. And then in 1975, the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association made it into a movie. Again, how many has ever seen that movie? One of the great inspirational movies that I've ever seen, one of the greatest. It's amazing how God worked in such powerful ways. Tell you what I'm going to do. If you don't already have anything planned and prepared for this evening, I'm going to show that movie in this auditorium at 6 o'clock tonight. So if you're not already, don't already have plans, come on over to the church at 6 o'clock and we'll just show The Hiding Place. If you've never seen it, fasten your safety belts. You are in for a blessing. Your faith is going to be renewed and strengthened by watching the story. This is one of the great stories of history, of how God worked in a miraculous way to turn an evil, destructive time around in so many wonderful ways. Amen. So that's at 6 o'clock tonight, The Hiding Place, right here in the auditorium.
the hiding place. Wow, what an awesome story. You know, the model for the hiding place, you can trace all the way back through history to different things that happen that we read about in the Bible. But the event that models this the best for us is the suffering of Jesus, where in the Garden of Gethsemane, the Bible says that he sweat, as it were, great drops of blood as he was about to suffer for the sins of the world. The question, why do the righteous suffer, is best answered in the context of why did Jesus have to suffer? And the suffering of Jesus was more horrible than anything that you or I could ever experience, because he not only suffered physically, he suffered eternal. He suffered the separation from his heavenly Father. He said, "Well, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And he took upon himself the sin of the world, and he paid the price of sin with his own precious blood. So anytime you might feel tempted to blame God for your personal suffering, remember that he suffered for you. And he is our great high priest who knows what we're going through. He understands our pain. He feels the infirmity, the feeling of our infirmity. He understands. He's a God that you and I can relate to, because he's been there, done that, he's gone through it, and he emerged out of his suffering victorious over it. Praise God. Amen. This is the part where we're supposed to start getting excited, okay? Amen. Here's what the Bible says about the ultimate victory. I believe in ultimate victory through faith in Christ. No matter what you have to go through, no matter what you face in life, no matter the trouble, no matter the pain, I want you to listen to this here in Romans chapter 8, beginning in verse 31. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died, and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Yet, in all these things, and as it says on the wall, we are more than conquerors through Christ who loved us. Amen. Amen. For I'm persuaded that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities or powers nor things present nor things to come nor height nor depth nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. 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 Our faith is perfected through suffering. We don't fully understand why God chose to do it this way in the world that he created. We know that sin has a lot to do with it, but we also believe in redemption. And so this is where we find our way forward in life when hard times come. This is how we deal with brokenness and craziness that we see going on all around about us. We go for a deepening of our faith by going deeper into God, deeper into his word, deeper into prayer, deeper into the fellowship, deeper into those things that we know are true and good. Hallelujah. Amen. You know, I'm thankful for the story of the hiding place. It's such a powerful message that speaks to us today, that is useful for us today, because in the midst of all of the horror and terror and fear and panic that was in the world at that time, there was a place where people could go to find comfort and to find safety. Where'd they go? They went to the hiding place. And what a coincidence! As I remember, this just popped into my mind. I think we sang about that today. You are my hiding place. Amen. That hiding place that Corrie Ten Boom wrote about and they made a movie of. Powerful movie. We have a hiding place. We have a place where we can go. We can run to the Lord. The name of the Lord is a strong and mighty tower. The righteous run to it and are saved. We run to God. We run to the Lord. We cast all our care on Him. We give Him our burdens. We seek His will. We seek His grace. We run to the Lord. And that's how we're closing this service this morning. If you're here today and if you want God's people to gather around and stand in the prayer of agreement for you, amen. We're going to stand today in faith, believing that God has a plan and purpose for what you're going through. And there's healing power in the name of Jesus. And if we don't understand how God is wanting to heal us, we can rest in the grace of God to strengthen us for whatever He might call upon us to experience as we move forward in life. Would you stand with me today? And I want us to sing that song again as we bring this service to a time of prayer at the altars. You know, God showed up at the beginning of this service, and I believe He's still here. I believe He's still here. And if you need to touch the hand of God today, if you need to go deeper in your faith today, I want you to come to the altar this morning. Those of you who have needs, and Tammy's going to come and stand in for my sister Colleen. Others, we want you to come and we'll pray together with you that God will make Himself real to you. And whatever it is that you're going through, there's a place that you can go. It's the hiding place. It's the place where God is, where you can reach out and take His hand. And He will not only comfort you, He will not only touch you, He will pour out His miracles in your life. He will also use you for His glory. He will turn it around into something good, a testimony that you can share with the world that Jesus is real and His love will comfort you and His power will deliver you in your time of trouble. Hallelujah. Father in heaven, we thank You today for the good news of the gospel that God so loved the world that He sent His only Son, and Jesus suffered and bled and died on the cross but rose again on the third day, so that no matter how dark our world might become, the light always shines from heaven. And today we're moving toward the light and we're reaching up to take the hand of God. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Would you come this morning if you'd like to have special prayer, if you'd like to have deeper faith, or if you'd just like to come and kneel at the altar and pray?